Would you pray with me? Come, Emmanuel, and fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle within us the fire of your love. And may my words and our hearts together glorify you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I imagine that each of us holds within our memory dates that have changed our lives. Think about it for a moment, won't you? Think back and remember a moment in which your life changed. While there are many dates that have changed my life, some difficult and some profoundly joyous, there is one that stands out for me today. On December 17th, 2010, I stood in front of a judge and heard her say, "Sydney, from now on, this is your forever Joey. Do you understand?" Now, even though I had been part of Sydney's life for quite a while, suddenly and very unexpectedly, my life changed. Suddenly, by order of the court, I was a parent. I had adopted Sydney Michelle Hudson, and in that unexpected moment, I knew that God had transformed my world, had broken apart my plans, reordered my dreams that, by the way, had never included being a parent. And I knew my life would never be the same again. Filled with awe and wonder, fear and trepidation, and certain hope, my life changed forever when I became Sydney's forever Joey. And you? What plans have you made? What dreams have you dreamed? What dates have changed your life forever? In today's gospel reading, we hear the priest Zechariah, the new father of an unexpected baby boy named John, sing the prelude to Christmas. You see, God had broken into Zechariah's world with news that though they were old, he and his wife Elizabeth would become parents. And true to God's word, their plans, their dreams changed unexpectedly. Though Zechariah had doubted the angel who had brought him this news and had been struck mute for 9 months, now God had made good on God's promises. And Zechariah held a baby in his arms. And I love what happens next. In that moment, the song in his heart explodes with pent-up praise. You know, I believe you know those moments. I believe you have had those moments. You know, those moments when you can't contain yourself because of your joy. You know those moments when God is so good and has been so faithful that you cannot help but want to sing right out loud, to dance with abandon. You know that moment when your heart is so full that you cannot help but cry and laugh all at the same time. But I want you to notice what Zechariah does. You see, the first words out of his mouth are not directed to his wife or even to his family. No, his first response is an unexpected, exuberant song of praise and adoration to God. You see, it turns out that God's disciplining of Zechariah by silencing his voice for 9 months for being so doubtful of God's promise was really an act of mercy, not judgment. So filled with the Holy Spirit, Zechariah breaks into prophetic praise, singing Benedictus, Dominus, Deus Israel. Blessed are you, Most High God of Israel. You see, in this song, this canticle that we for centuries now have called the Benedictus, Zechariah is seeing past his own personal joy into the future. Zechariah has sensed with the birth of this child who would become John the Baptist, the herald of the coming of the birth of Jesus Christ into the world, that God is on the move. God is breaking into the world. And this is not just now some personal song of praise and thanksgiving, but a song of God's redemption of the whole world. And so, Zechariah looks back to the God who was and sings about a promise made to the great King David. He looks back to Abraham and Sarah, so like he and his wife Elizabeth, old in years but promised a child. The promise that through Abraham and Sarah, God would make a nation more numerous than the stars. Zechariah looks back to the God who was and sings of the prophets who themselves were standing on tiptoe, straining to see the day that God would come among the people and shepherd them. He looks back over history of God's people being oppressed and hated, overthrown by one empire after another, Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Rome. And yet he praises God that all this trouble has been leading to the arrival of a baby who will embody God's plan of the salvation of all people, the Messiah, the one who makes sense of the past, all of our pasts. So what were the difficult things for you in this year of our Lord, 2012? What is it that has caused you to question who you are and why you are here? What is it that has broken your heart and caused you to fear the future? And you know, it isn't just people who have those kinds of times. Our church has been through so many ups and downs, so many challenges, not the least of which happened this year as we made hard choices about our budget, cut our spending, and then said farewell to people on our staff whom we loved and still love, considering them our family, a heartache of heartaches. Certainly, we all have those hard heartache times in our lives and in our journeys of faith. But what if Zechariah's song is a clue for us? Could it be possible that this song is telling us that God's grace and presence are to be found in all our troubles and our difficulties? Is it possible that our troubles can throw us right into the arms of God, who offers us salvation and hope and peace? Of course, it is important to say here that the way that we think of the word salvation is not at all the same as the way people of Jesus' day thought of salvation. You see, we get all caught up in salvation as having to do with eternal life and being able to work our way into avoiding hell or gaining heaven. But you see, for people in Jesus' day and for centuries before and after that, salvation was a word that was about being restored to wholeness. Salvation was a word about being restored into right relationship with God. In other words, this Savior, this Messiah of whom Zechariah sings, would free us from an absorption with ourselves and would restore us to wholeness from any and all of our shortcomings. And you see, Zechariah doesn't just look back at the God who was, but then begins to look back at the God who will be. And so, looking into the future, Zechariah looks at the birth of this child whom he now holds in his arms and causes him to look forward. When Zechariah becomes a new father and when he sings of his joy as he gazes at his newborn son, it is as if he yearns even more deeply for peace. Doesn't the need for peace in the world and the healing of creation become more pressing when we have children whose futures stretch out beyond our own? Zechariah sings of the restoration of things to what they can be, what they ought to be. And when he sings of God's forgiveness, he isn't describing some legalistic transaction, a reward we earn by our deeds, but rather a movement, a journey of our hearts into the heart of God. That's what babies do, you know. Babies cause us to look into our future because our children and our grandchildren, our nieces and our nephews, our children who come here every Sunday, who belong to us, carry the hopes of a better world for which we long. This was especially true of Zechariah's baby, because this child, John, as Zechariah sings about the future, sings about God's future governed by God's covenant with us, by God's faithfulness to be with us, by God's offer of salvation for all people, and by God's promise of peace. Zechariah sings of the connection between our small lives and the larger events of history. His song vibrates with equality and vibrates for our personal hopes and fears that you and I and all people carry, even as he sings of God at work in the grand sweep of history. You see, Zechariah and Elizabeth are experiencing the most remarkable things happening to them personally. But as they look at their baby and as they see God's promises kept for their whole people, past, present, and even more the wonders of the future, they are seeing a God who was and is and shall ever be, and they are seeing that promise unfold in the story of God at work in the world. And I just want to ask you this Advent, can you do that? Can you see the God of the future this morning? Can you look into God's future for your life in 2013? Can you see the new possibilities for being available to God, for being God's person? Can you imagine that you are part of something greater than yourself? Can we together dream of what our church might be as we take up Zechariah's song? Can our country, split by partisan politics, take up the song of hope and peace? Can our world, torn apart by war and violence against creation, be transformed into a vision of peace? You see, the truth is, every now and then, it happens. Every now and then, the song of God's peace and God's faithfulness, the song of God's salvation unexpectedly breaking into our world occurs. It actually happened. in 1914. In 1914, in the first year of World War I, on Christmas Day, German, British, and French soldiers disobeyed their superiors and fraternized with the enemy along two-thirds of the Western Front. German troops held Christmas trees up out of the trenches with signs that read, "Merry Christmas," and "You no shoot, we no shoot." Thousands of troops streamed across a no man's land. They sang Christmas carols, exchanged photographs of loved ones back home, shared rations, and played football. Soldiers embraced men they had been trying to kill a few short hours before. They agreed to warn each other if the top brass forced them to fire their weapons, and if that happened, that they would shoot high. It didn't last. A shudder ran through the high command on all sides. Here was a disaster in the making, soldiers declaring their brotherhood with each other and refusing to fight. Generals on all sides declared this spontaneous peacemaking to be treasonous and subject to court-martial. By March 1915, the fraternization movement had been eradicated, and the killing machine put back in full operation. And by the time of the armistice in 1918, 15 million would be slaughtered. And yet, for one brief, shining, unexpected moment, there was peace. They beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks, and war was no more. And in that moment, there was an unexpected peace. It seems impossible. It seems impossible to dream that for us this Advent, that enemies might become friends, that brokenness might be made whole, that the earth might be healed, and that the world might know peace, and that our church might live into its potential, and that our personal stories, yours and mine, might be filled with hope and peace. Yes, it seems impossible, but if they, in the throes of war, could do it, perhaps we can too. Perhaps we can lay down our animosity toward our family members and friends, our colleagues and co-workers. Perhaps it is not so impossible to do, because every light that unexpectedly breaks through, every blessing that suddenly heals our heart and gives us hope, every newborn baby or newborn dream that startlingly reminds us of the newness of God's tender mercies each morning is an Advent. A coming of God to us, God with us, God born in us, a taste of what is yet to come, a sign of what God is doing in unlikely places, with unlikely people, in unexpected ways. And that's always our hope, isn't it? The hope of humanity, your hope and my hope, that whatever bad thing is occurring now, it won't last forever. That the light of hope melting away into an unexpected peace will dissolve the fog of fear and hatred, obsession and judgment, loneliness, illness, heartache that obscures our vision of God's future. So in these short days and long nights of Advent, let us take up Zechariah's song, because it is the song that is a prelude to Christmas and the one who comes. Let us take up Zechariah's song, singing as he sang. Such is the tender mercy of our God, who from on high will bring the rising sun to visit us, to give light to those who live in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. May it be so today and tomorrow. May it be so yesterday, today and tomorrow. So come, Emmanuel. Come, Emmanuel. Come, Emmanuel. Amen.
The Cathedral of Hope of the United Church of Christ in Dallas, Texas, has shared God's word of hope with a hurting world. And it's not so much about our church as it is about our God who created us and loves us beyond our wildest imagination.
I didn't come out until I was 40 years old, and I thought God had written me off.
As a preacher's kid, my faith and sexuality were always separate.
Before 1979, on the weekends, I usually went out bar hopping, and I'd come home, had a few too many and didn't sleep too well.
The harder I struggled, how can I be gay and be a Christian?
For a long time, I felt like my sexuality was tearing my mother away from her religion, and I was ashamed.
May 16th, 1993, I walked into the Cathedral of Hope. I sat on the next to the last pew, and God said to me, "You are exactly where I want you."
The cathedral has become my home, and it's also become my family's home.
The next day, on Monday, I came and saw her, and I says, "Hey, I'm a beginner. I don't know what to do. Do you take beginners in this church?" And that was the change on the 30th.
I finally came out, and at the Cathedral of Hope, I found love and healing.
I now have direction in my life.
We're able to worship together as a family.
This is Jeanette.
And this is Antonio.
I'm Jess.
My name is Robert.
I'm Jenny.
My name is Brian.
I'm Scott.
It was January 26, 2003.
June 15, 2006.
My life changed December 30th, 1979.
July 22nd, 2011.
Our date is May 7, 2006.
August 13th, 1995.
For every date, there is a person who has discovered the extravagant, radical, relentless love of God. And each date marks the moment when someone placed their faith in God. Thanks to your generosity, the Cathedral of Hope has been helping people discover their own story and their own experience of God's amazing grace. Know that your sacrificial giving makes a difference. Your gifts are changing lives.
Every time I walk through the doors of the Cathedral of Hope, it's a life-changing date for me.